So just to kick it off, I thought it'll be good, you know, for all of you to just share a little bit about how this journey has been in terms of, you know, how you got started, about the investors, day-to-day, how does it feel, and where do you think, are you mature enough? Have you started making money? you know, so I'll like to start with Geetha, if you can just talk through it, Geetha.
Sure. Very good afternoon. And as Asha said, between lunch and you, so let's see. Yeah, so our startup is called Niramai. And I always love to say what Niramai means. It means healthy in Sanskrit, and it has an expansion, non-invasive risk assessment through machine artificial intelligence. So essentially, we are using AI to detect breast cancer, as Asha said. You know, it probably will not be as a typical IoT kind of a device. Yes, we have devices in different hospitals and we try to control. But it has been an interesting journey, especially from healthcare perspective. There are several additional hurdles you need to sort of pass. To just sort of say how I started, I started looking at a very personal problem, like my very close family member was detected with breast cancer. And I just said, like, let's try and do something to detect early, because I realized that there is no solution to detect breast cancer in women under 45 years of age, for example. Absolutely no solution, only hand. And even if there is a solution, such as mammography, it is not affordable, accessible to people in India. There's no awareness. And a lot of these issues we wanted to solve. And so we came up with this new method where we tried to first, of course, address early detection, address the fact that we can do breast cancer screening in women of all age groups, as well as making it more affordable, accessible. Finally, making it very privacy aware so that, you know, nobody sees or touches the person during this process. So the lady feels completely, no, she doesn't shy away, at least completely comfortable doing this, right? So we try to sort of look at experience of the end user and trying to address all of those issues. So like any other startup, of course, we have the first issue was to raise funds because, you know, we decided to sort of focus on the software part because that's what I knew better. And so the hardware for the IoT, if you will, we decided to sort of procure from elsewhere, right, off the shelf, because it's a thermal imaging device. It's available outside. It's really about how to use it for healthcare as opposed to some other sensors. So we didn't focus on the hardware part, but how do we utilize the sensing output is where we focused on. So currently, these devices are pretty expensive, so really needed to raise money to even do experiments. And as you may be aware, for healthcare, you know, you can't just sort of go and say, okay, come over, I'm going to do a test and I want to collect data. It's not possible. As opposed to sticking sort of, you know, devices around this room is not so harmful, right? So first and foremost, we need to get ethics clearance from the hospital to touch the patients or even get the consent from the end user. They're very scared, like, you know, what if the device says yes when there's no cancer? That is also harmful because the lady will be always, you know, having that thought in her head, like, you know, even though there is no problem, she'll be thinking at, or, you know, on that particular day, like somebody told I may have cancer. So it's like very dangerous to call out false positives. It is also obviously dangerous to miss out cancer because, you know, obviously we will feel guilty, you know, we missed that cancer and I'm responsible for death and all that kind of thing. So the one part clearly is, first, how do we get the data from the hospital, from the patient? So there, this is something I never knew when I decided to quit my, you know, luxurious job and then I said, I'm going to come on the road, right? You know, it's not just easy to just say, you know, you use it, right? So, and I thought, okay, I can go to the hospital. We had several relationships. So we will say, okay, why don't we start collecting? No, there is a very, very, you know, clear process called ethics committee approval, scientific committee approval. And what is this committee is not from the hospital, by the way. It is, it has about, let's say, 12 different disciplines. People from 12 different disciplines have to come together. This board has to be approved by some central authority. I don't know exactly which authority, maybe DCGI, that this constitution is, you know, independent to say that whatever test we are doing is not going to harm the patient. It is going to help in one way or the other. And of course, it has to move the science also, right? So all of these have to be proven. The good part is because our solution was non-invasive, so the side effect part was very less. Only thing is we were taking 15 minutes of the time, so that was easy. But still getting this, all the paperwork done, and it was like huge. So that is one piece. So those of you who are planning for healthcare, you know, startup, which is very good, by the way, I'm not discouraging you. It's one of the most fulfilling projects I've ever done in my life, right? I've done like hundreds of projects. But so that way it's very, very useful. But these are some of the steps you need to pass, I would say. I'm not going to scare you. So, but the ethics committee approval for every hospital, to just give you an idea without naming the hospital, we got the ethics committee approval last year. Even now, we have not been able to start in this particular hospital because there are several other aspects, you know, getting a room assigned, you know, who will pass the, you know, the patient to come to that particular room when she comes to the reception for taking a test. You know, several of these workflow issues and so on. So the data collection is one of the major, you know, hurdles. Thankfully, HCG, Narayana Hrudayalaya, and these kind of hospitals have very good ethics committee, separate, what you call, clinical research teams, which are pretty active, and so it was helpful. So that was the first part, right? Which I'm just trying to focus on healthcare pieces, which are going to be different. And I mean, too much? No. Okay, I'll ahead. Finish it off.
Finish
so next part is the regulatory aspect of it. Like even, let's say we get a very good accuracy. Before you put your first device in the market, you want to make sure that, you know, regulatory guys are not going to come with a legal letter, right? So you will have to get through the regulatory procedure. So this kind of thing basically sort of delays your first, you know, commercial installation, I would say. Talking about the healthcare overall scheme of things and startups around, let's say, Fitbit we discussed, right? The wearables is one place where IoT is really, really used. And one thought that that comes to my mind is really about the veracity of data that we need to take care of, which is how do you know that the data that is coming to you is the correct data? So we can say we have the best algorithm to detect cancer, but the most of the effort in the last 1.5 years after we put it on in real hands of somebody else, like a nursing staff who is running between multiple tests and she has only 15 minutes to do this test, right? We are so conscious, so nervous about what kind of mistakes she'll do. And so all of our new IP that we have created is all about how do we ensure the lady doesn't do mistakes when collecting the data. And it's also a good green field, right? So that's another thing I want to say. There are lots of things. Maybe we'll hear in the rest of the thing. I'll let others speak. Sorry.
Thanks, Geetha. Abhay, coming over to you, like if you can share a little bit about, you know, journey. And also, you know, give the audience a flavor about how do you actually go ahead and get funding, and is that the biggest challenge, or is it more about then scaling, or when do you actually start saying that, okay, you know, you've started feeling like you are making it, for lack of a better term?
Okay. So let me just step back in terms of what we do. So we are a company that designs and develops edge processing devices, where the entire analytics, the machine learning analytics, is run on the edge device. So we don't need to connect to servers. Essentially, it's a standalone device. It has multiple sensors, the biggest one being video. So we essentially do video analytics at the edge. We also have other sensors which manage motion and so on when the devices are, let's say, put into a vehicle. So there are multiple other sensors that we analyze. Our journey started about 10 years back, of course, not in terms of analytics. So we started in terms of being a video management company, so where we were letting a lot of our customers in retail centrally manage content which was being displayed inside their retail stores, where what is to be displayed was being driven by our software and the devices, the media players which were in the field. And from there, we really started understanding the customer value, which is, you know, you're playing all this content, but who's actually watching it? Do you really know who are the people who are, what is the audience? Have you actually looked at their ad, the content which is being played? And therefore, we started our journey into providing analytics, and which finally, you know, through multiple steps, led us to creating this device, which does the analytics at the edge. So, you know, our customers are in retail segment, but it's really a, it's really a horizontal because the use cases for video analytics go into multiple industries. In fact, we do have clients who use it in for transportation, logistics, so on. So essentially, our pitch is, you know, whatever a human eye can do, the same can be replicated, but obviously 24/7 without making mistakes, and so on. In terms of our journey, so we were sort of initially funded through some angels, you know, essentially friends, well-wishers who put in the the early capital. Post that, actually, we haven't really raised money because for a startup, I think the most important concern really for us was to get our technology platform right. And for us, the journey really has been in the last several years has been to identify the right technology components in terms of what is the platform that we need to use, what are the sensors that we need to use. And I think over the last 2 or 3 years, we've experimented with several possibilities, and we have finally latched onto one. And we believe in that journey, it was important for us to really have that independence so that, you know, we are not being pushed by the investors who clearly are going to come in with objectives which are slightly different from the founding team. And of course, there are challenges with that, with having to manage that journey on your own. But I think for us, the important thing was to reach a stage where we are able to independently analyze and make decisions about our product. And I think we reached a stage where our product now is in a shape where we believe we have a stable platform. And, you know, this is the stage where we are now starting to look at scaling up, and which is where the funding really is required, which is to help us scale, not really to help us define the product, which I think we did it on our own steam, but to scale up, and, you know, and therefore we require a different type of capital infusion at this stage. So that's where we are in terms of our journey.
That's great to hear. Derick, I know, you know, oil and gas industry is going through a different and a difficult, challenging phase for the last few years, right? So is using artificial intelligence and machine learning really something that will get the industry from that slump? Or, like, how has been the thought process around, you know, forming Flutura, and then, you know, what problems are you kind of trying to solve there?
So in terms of starting the company, the seed got formed. We were working in a services company.
Okay.
And none of us had created products, none of us had sold. We had a very specific customer interaction working in a services company where the three of us were trying to generate ideas and make him think differently. And he looked at us with a poker face and said, "Guys, you guys are supposed to be cheaper. You're not supposed to generate ideas for us." And that's when we said, we had to do something about this. And we said, we started the journey of saying we had to create something where they do not perceive us as being only a cost arbitrator. So we thought we'll create a product company where we are faster, better, but not cheaper. We'll at least be at the same price. Okay, that's the thought process. We didn't know. So we asked ourselves two questions. Where do we play and how do we play? So we said consumer-facing industries was very populated. So we started focusing on the machine world. We'll squeeze machine data instead of customer data. And we did a couple of experiments there and finally narrowed it down to upstream oil and gas and specialty chemicals, where checks were getting written and budgets were allocated. Okay, so you had visibility into that. So that's how we narrowed on where to play. How to play, and again, from a geography perspective, again, the second dimension of where to play, we experimented a lot of places, Brunei, Malaysia, for oil and gas, Middle East, where we had a lot of Malu friends. Finally, it didn't work out, but went to Houston, which was kind of the Silicon Valley of industrial, I would say, because they take a lot of bold bets, and found a way through. So now the second question, which we are still in the process of answering, is how to play. In the sense of, do we go direct? Because this was an industry which was not used to consuming from startups, A. B, and a lot of safety issues, reliability issues. You had to have a trusted brand. They don't buy from a young startup. We got a lot of early breakthroughs, but I would say if we have to scale, we'll have to partner. So three lessons we learned was we'll have to heavily verticalize, we'll have to globalize, and this is a very cartelized industry, we have to join the cartelize also. So, yeah.
Okay. So that's nice. And then Karan, about Intellicar, you know, can you share a little bit about your journey and, you know, similar thoughts?
Sure. Hi. Good afternoon, everybody. Just to give you a little insight of our journey, how we started, the challenges that we essentially faced. So this is back in 2014 and 2015, where we were looking at the IoT space, me, my co-founder, my CTO, and you know, we began to understand that the IoT space has huge potential, whether it is automotive, healthcare, oil and gas, industrial IoT, and where do we essentially focus? We narrowed down our focus to automotive primarily because one, I come with an experience of automotive, we understand vehicles, we had a team that understands vehicles. And that's when the journey began. And the big question at that point of time was, how do we get into the market? Who are our target customers? Are we targeting OEMs, for example? Are we targeting end consumers, end customers, for example? So back in 2015, we said, okay, let's go into the B2C space. We saw a lot of action of this happening with usage-based insurance in Western world, in Europe and US, and that began to gain traction. So we quickly built a product that focused on the B2C space and began to talk to people. We thought our best entry would be through dealerships who could essentially promote this product and begin to sell this product to anybody who's buying a particular vehicle, mostly a car. We then realized quickly in the next 6 months that the B2C space is not going to scale, especially when you look at the usage-based insurance, because the insurance segment in India is highly regulated, and for them to bring about changes, drastic changes, is extremely difficult. So we quickly realized that the B2C space in India is still going to take some time to scale, and even if it has to, it requires a lot of money, a lot of funding to be able to, just get the word out there, get marketing out there. So looking at that point in time, Uber, Ola companies, shared mobility companies began to rise up a lot, and we began to do some analysis and realize that, the only way these companies, any large fleet companies going forward, is going to be profitable is if they have a handle on their maintenance costs. And realizing that and realizing the amount of data that we are able to extract from vehicles today, we quickly pivoted the business model, pivoted the platform into focusing on B2B space. At that point in time, late 2015, we were the only B2B OBD-based telematics company at that point in time in India. And we quickly began to realize that our first low-hanging fruit, so to speak, would be shared mobility companies, tech companies who are running large fleets, who understand tech and how they can leverage data to be able to make better business decisions. So we began to focus on 2-3 tech companies and began to work with them, very closely to understand the kind of challenges they face and be able to show them data and value from the vehicles that they have running on how we could save money, what would be the cost impact, what would be the ROI for them. And we quickly then, began to realize that, okay, this seems to be picking up traction, because at that point in time, telematics was only track and trace. And track and trace is a very, very basic feature when it comes to telematics. We began to focus on two things that affect cost, maintenance. So we began to focus on predictive maintenance. And the next thing was driver behavior. How does driver behavior affect safety? How does driver behavior affect vehicle maintenance and operational costs? So these two were the big levers that we began to realize that could essentially help a lot of companies, apart from track and trace, of course, being the base solution. From there to today, we have close to 300 customers. We are profitable today, completely profitable, and we have close to 60,000 plus assets that we track on the ground today.
That's fantastic to hear. I was kind of reading an article which was about, when do you know a startup has become mature? And, it said there needs to be like 4 parameters, and you guys can tell me if that's right or not. I think the first one was really about loving what you do, which I guess that's why you start one in the first place. The second was about being profitable, which, Karan just spoke about. I think the third one was people chasing you, then you chasing people. And then the fourth thing was around having the option to take a vacation. So, as you have gone through this journey, have you been your biggest challenges? Either is it technology, is it the ecosystem, is it investment? Is it similar in these areas or different by industry? So some thoughts on that, I think, will be very helpful.
Let me start. I think one of the issues we've personally faced is around technology choices and the hardware ecosystem in India. So, you know, we ventured into the hardware development with really very little prior experience. Most of us came from the software industry, and we thought it was easy to, you know, sort of replicate what a mobile phone does, because a lot of the sensors, analytics, etc., is what a mobile phone today gives. And the challenges that we face are multiple. Of course, one is, you know, lack of sufficient experience within the ecosystem itself. So it's very hard to find talent. It's very hard to find people who have the experience curve of going through multiple product development. It's very hard to source components that we need for testing and execution. Cycles are extremely long. So unlike software, obviously hardware cycles are long, but they are further prolonged by uncertainties in our supply chain. So, you know, this is something which perhaps NASSCOM and the government needs to look at as to, you know, how do we, if you want to talk about make in India, we need to be able to support players like us who need to access components fast and be able to sort of test them. So for us, the one big challenge has been, you know, how do we deal with hardware? I mean, we've gone through that personal learning ourselves. We chose, I think unlike you mentioned, you know, where the device came from outside, we chose to go through the route of developing and designing everything from scratch ourselves. Extremely arduous, but I think that helped us identify sweet spots where the customer would see value in terms of the final product that we deliver. But the journey has been extremely long, and that can be, I think, for many other startups who are now starting off, they need not go through the same process. You know, if we have a better ecosystem where we are able to facilitate people like us to, you know, sort of get access to technology components, be able to import stuff. We also need to be able to do pilots, especially in government, because, you know, government is a big user of many of these technologies. And there are onerous conditions for people, for small startups to really qualify, including revenue, profitability, et cetera. And while profitability obviously is the end goal for all of us, for technology companies, you know, you have to make investments. And therefore, it is unlikely that, you know, somebody is going to be profitable from the get-go. Yeah. So how do you break, you know, this vicious cycle of, you know, you having to display profitability to be able to qualify for, you know, many new projects which are being launched, smart cities, for example. You know, there are a lot of good technologies which are being developed by, you know, small startups like us. But we need to be given the right platform. So that is one of the hurdles that, you know, we faced and, you know, sort of continue to battle with.
Other thoughts?
For us, the number one problem was basically, I would say mental models of the industrial guys, because they always believed electromechanical can add more value than anything digital, which is intangible, right? So that is number one. And secondly, linking the output we do, analytical output, to really dollars, that believability. And took a lot of efforts and experiments before both got solved.
I already mentioned about the trials and regulatory. In addition, in terms of customer acceptance, right, we are talking to doctors, and I think all of us will agree, doctors are like not the first people to adopt technology, right? You know, there are some, maybe there are exceptions, but most people are busy actually saving lives, which is good for us. So, so first thing is, like, if you say there is a tool which is going to help, and the cancers which have never been, you know, detected can be detected automatically. I mean, obviously, everyone, if I were in their place, I would have got nervous about it, right? Because one is about the job security, which I haven't faced that much, but more in terms of believability, as he was saying, about the results itself. How do you know? So we had to really go through testing times, if you will, literally testing, where, you know, we make our patient actually go through our test and blindfolded, literally blindfolded, and the person goes to other three, four tests, which, and then we do a comparison. Some comparisons are done after almost 1 year, right? You know, because all the data, you never see in between. So you don't have any way to fine tune whatever. Once given frozen, it's called locked model. Once locked, it's locked. So this is what we went through. But now we are like, you know, happy that the results are accepted. So that is one, acceptance by the end user part. And mindset of wellness to, you know, is still nascent in India overall, and women taking care of their health rather than taking care of their family, you know, that kind of prioritization is also a little bit of an issue. So because of that, we try to do a lot of these awareness camps, you know, because people don't know that if they don't detect early, they actually may lose their life, you know, which is more harmful to their family than even getting to know that the person has cancer, right? So these are some mindset issues that we are tackling at this stage. Talking about profitability, no, we are not yet profitable, so you can call us immature, but I think we qualify among the other three parameters you mentioned, thankfully. I was waiting, at least there is one which says so. But nevertheless, I think as a startup, it's a journey of learning. So I don't know whether there's any maturity level as such. There's always learning. You want to do more and more. And particularly as a deep tech startup, you know, I think one of the key value propositions we are bringing to science and medical domain is the new technology that we are developing. So if I say, okay, we want to develop a preventive screening test and full stop, and I just want to sell, I think we are good. And like, you know, we are doing well and we are getting good revenues and we are able to do. But I think our ambition is much, much higher because we feel, okay, how do we make this usable, not by a doctor, but even a 12th class person, so that everyone in every rural area, every, you know, person gets access. How do we make this available on a small device, mobile phone, so every PHC will have it. So once your ambition is higher, so obviously, as you were saying, we have to invest in it as well. And so that's where you know, the profitability kind of suffers. And actually, maybe I'll let others ask questions to answer any other challenges.
Yeah, sure. You know, I think one of the things actually all of the startups have done to the corporates is make them more agile on their feet. I sit on the other side of the fence. I think because they have seen the possibilities. I think the ability to risk take grows higher. And I hope that helps open the doors for startups to many of these, like what you were talking about. I think we have around 10, 12 minutes. So I would really, you know, open it up to the audience to ask questions. Sure. People are listening. Very curious to hear you.
So to just give you an understanding of challenges that we faced and we faced in the initial days, challenges that we continue to face today as a so-called mature startup, but according to me, I think we're still young, we're not mature yet. But so one of the initial challenges that we faced were, how do we get, you know, large tech companies to actually believe in us and, you know, give us that opportunity to be able to work with them. And I'll just tell you one of the stories that we went through. So we were working, I will not name the company, but it'll be pretty obvious, one of the large ride-hailing companies in India. And we were trying to work with them for, you know, trying to help them improve their maintenance cost and, you know, improve their driver behavior and their vehicle health. And, you know, we kept running pilots with them. These pilots went on for 3 months, 4 months, 5 months. And there was nobody really willing to take that decision to say, you know, hey, we want to go with you. We want to, we'll take that risk with going with a young company compared to a matured company, which would just give me a track and trace solution. So we had to essentially come out with something out of the box to, you know, convince them to come with us. So one of the key things that we did was essentially kept our eyes and ears open, listened to the news to see what was happening. And one of the things that was affecting these companies at that point in time was fake trips, right? A lot of these drivers made a lot of fake trips and they made a lot of money through incentives because of these fake trips. So we said, you know, we have about 200, 300 of our devices in their cars. Can we figure out how we can solve this problem for them? Maybe that gives them that confidence. We began to comb through the data that we were collecting, tried to collect more data from the vehicles, and one important aspect came out. We realized that whenever there was a fake trip, none of the car doors opened or closed. right? And that was a very, very simple data point that we took to them and said, you know, out of these cars, these many cars had fake trips because of such and such reason, right? And the doors never opened, and they began to comb through, and they began to understand that, saying, hey, yeah, actually, these were counted as fake trips for us as well. And that gave them the confidence to take the next leap and say, you know, let us move forward, because that was essentially one of the defining things that happened to us. One of the challenges that is continuously ongoing is, you know, data, because we handle companies' data. All companies become very nervous the more we scale with them, because it's all about, hey, you guys have all our data. We should be owning the data. Data belongs to us. The data should be housed with us. You know, we need to figure that out. And I think, you know, people look at data as a commodity. People say data is the next oil. It absolutely is. But it only becomes valuable once you begin to use that data and share that data around the ecosystem to create value. Hoarding data doesn't really make it valuable. It's not gold, where I continue to hold it and the price of gold increases the next year, right? So this is a challenge that we continue to face, and giving confidence to even large OEMs that we work with today is seemingly a difficult challenge, because they don't know what to do with the data, but they still believe data is valuable and the data has to be owned and housed with them, but they don't know how to do it. So that becomes a continuous challenge that we face, and I think we will continue to face in this ecosystem. So.
Yeah, my question is to Karan. You rightly pointed out usage-based insurance is a big area for insurance companies, because 40% of their revenue comes from motor insurance. Regulatory environment is sort of developing. IRDA recently allowed sandboxes for insurance companies to come and experiment. And they are cautious because policyholders' protection is a big concern for them. Now, coming on to the value proposition of telematics, there is a device-based element which you install in your car, and it gives you information about the engine maintenance and all. There is a certain element of dilution in that value, because there are companies who are making apps which you can install in your phone. It uses phone sensors to figure out whether you're accelerating or, you know, making quick turns. So that is one area of driver behavior which can sort of get diluted. What is your thought on that? That is first part. Second part is, in terms of telematics, which with the advent of autonomous cars, it's not there yet. With recent disasters in automotive cars, it may take more time. So what are your thoughts? If automotive car becomes a norm, then what happens to the telematics?
Okay, so to answer your first question, you know, about insurance and where we see the value proposition with phones. See, I believe that phones give you a decent amount of insight into driver behavior, but you don't get the full picture. Just to give you an understanding, my data can change coming from the phone depending on where I place the phone in the car while I drive, right? If, for example, I always mount the phone on one particular location, data begins to become more accurate. I can filter out the noise. But let's say my phone is placed in a cup holder, right? Or it's placed in my pocket that's moving around, right? How do I then begin to accurately filter out the noise, right? What we do with driver behavior is we get accelerometer data from our device as well. That's very similar to what you get from your phone. But we mount the device in a particular way. The device is mounted and it's firmly fixed in a particular position, so the data and the noise is essentially reduced. Two, the other way of looking at driver behavior is we take live data points from the vehicle, and just one data point from a vehicle can tell me if a person's aggressive, and that is the accelerator pedal position at high frequency, right? And if I know the driver is constantly flooring it and 100% throttle back to zero, 100 back to zero constantly, this gives me a very significant understanding if the driver is aggressive, right? This is a way more accurate way to tell you if a driver is aggressive compared to a phone-based analytics. But phone-based analytics offers a more cheaper alternative compared to device-based telematics. But that being said, tampering and, you know, turning off the phone when I don't want data to go as well is very easy. Your second question about autonomous driving, I think India, especially as a country, is really far away from autonomous driving and autonomous vehicles. There's always going to be a state when autonomous driving comes in that you're going to have people driving as well as autonomous cars moving around, right? Now, how do autonomous cars understand how people drive? And if you look at data, how people drive in Bangalore compared to how people drive in Bombay and Delhi are significantly different, right? Now, this data is extremely critical to help autonomous cars learn how people drive and how do I coexist with people driving in autonomous cars. So the data that use that can be used for training this becomes extremely, extremely critical.
All right. Hi, I'm Venkat. And just from an early startup perspective, it's always, there are two things that we look at. One is establishing the confidence of the customer, and then the other side, the investor. And we go through a lot of process about prototyping and then going on with pilots and partnering with people and, you know, getting the first paycheck out. I've understood a bit about how the customer confidence is established. Now I want to ask you about the other end. So how did you successfully establish confidence from an investor? And this is open to all.
Yeah, I think first and foremost, it's the trust first and then the confidence, right? From my perspective, we do have wonderful investors who believe in the vision and so on. Having said that, they have actually parked quite a bit of money on your head. Like, it's almost like they're just believing in you and putting that money on their head, literally, right? So, of course, there's the market and need and all that. Finally, you're the one, like as a founder or a founding team, who will make or break that possibility. So one is them having trust in the person, capability-wise and so on. Second also is the transparency. This I've faced in many occasions in board meeting. I'll say, like, why don't they understand? This is so important for the company, but still they're not saying. But then I go back and then say, oh, yeah, I didn't give them enough information for them to agree that my decision is. This happens, right? I'm sure many of you in board meeting. Initially, in seed round, it's okay for everything. Yes, yes, yes. After that, every decision, there is a lot of discussion because now you are the risk versus reward is much higher, right? The differentiation is higher. So you need to. So there, I think being very transparent. And in fact, I had an opportunity to meet Eric Schmidt and I asked him this exact question, right? In a different fashion. I said, if you feel it's the best right thing to do, but the board is not feeling it, right? What's going wrong, right? Because and then he mentioned this to me, like, say this, in multiple forms. Don't take like 5 minutes and then give all the credit, because for a human mind, and they're not in it, they're not thinking about the same problem like you are doing 24/7, right? So they're not in that full context. So to bring them to the same context that you have in mind, it may be like one meeting or multiple meetings, setting the overall ground reality of, let's say it could be ecosystem, market, whatever, and then say what is the advantage you have and how this advantage can be morphed by this particular decision. Taking them along, right? Being transparent about it is one main thing, I would say, is all that is required. They are not going to see whether your revenue numbers are like $10 less than what you promised. Those are not at all important, actually. So that's my learning, actually, in the last 6 months particularly.
From our same experience, our investor said one of the most important things they saw in the founders was founder breakup. So one of the proxies they use is how long have you known each other for? Okay, and so 12 years we have known each other. So so that was one important signal. And we had some gray hair and a lot of passion.
I think just to add to what Geetha mentioned, I think we've seen what's worked best is when we go back to both our investors and clients when we fail. It's, when you succeed, it's always, everyone goes and shares the success. But I think it's when we fail, when you take some decisions and they didn't go well. And that's when you go back and explain, what had happened and what you're trying to do about it. And I think that builds a lot of trust with both investors as well as clients. And of course, we've seen more of this with clients where your ability to be with them, when things are not going well, really helps gain the confidence, the trust, which then, allows you to draw from it later. You get the credits, you earn your credits, and then you sort of go back with them. And that helps them when you're going through rough patches, which, of course, all of us go through.
Any last question? I think we have one.
So this is to any one of you. One of the challenges you will see in most of these technologies is that you have spent a lot of time, the cycles have been long for you because you were probably one of the early ones in the game. But catch up is fairly straightforward because technology allows you to catch up fairly quickly. So how do you stay ahead of competition, or how do you differentiate? Or stay differentiated, rather, that's the better way to put it.
My personal thought on that is, I think you're absolutely right. You spend a lot of time building a new solution, building a new product, going to market with it, and then somebody, you know, copying it, and then lowering the price, and then, you know, scaling as quick as you. I think, the whole idea here is for you to constantly keep innovating, right? You need to keep listening to the customer. I don't believe that our product is ever going to be completely ready. I think the way people use that product constantly keeps changing, and as they get more mature with using that particular solution or product, they have more and more requirements, right? Today, if I give them 5 data points, that begins to feel very overwhelming for them, right? But 6 months down the line, once they've been constantly tracking these 5 data points and using that to make business decisions, that becomes very routine work for them, right? Now, how do I add more value? How do other data points begin to fit in here to be able to solve various pain points? So constantly being in touch with the customer and constantly innovating on that front, I think, is key to stay ahead.
Yeah, I agree with that. And same, innovating towards the customer as well as innovating on the tech side as well, right? If tech is the edge, right? Even the very small startup, I have a separate research team and an engineering, product engineering team. It's a 2-member research team, but there it is, right? With goals, which are like patents and so on, so which saying, okay, we are covering these innovations as well. We have 9 granted patents already, and you know, we keep filing as well. Of course, you can always circumvent patents that you file, but once you say, okay, your startup has these, at least serious companies will not try to replicate what you're doing. So these two things we do, and we do. I always tell my team, you know, spend at least 2 hours every week reading about what others are doing in your own field, so you can keep abreast. And it's also a development goal for each of the team members.
I think for some of us who are business focused, one of the key differentiators when it comes to scaling up is really our network. As I think Derick was also mentioning, we can't do everything alone. And you know, for us, most of the work in terms of actual deployment in the field, et cetera, is done through partners. And it's really the strength of the partnerships which will help, you know, we think, which will help us succeed, not just the product itself. So you know, while there may be, obviously, there will be new companies who will come and probably develop something either cheaper or with newer technology, but it's not easy for them to sort of easily get in with partners into the clients with the same amount of trust and confidence that they have. So I think that hopefully will keep us, you know, ahead of the game.
So I think our time is up. You know, very, very interesting discussion with some very good thoughts. Just to summarize, you know, and from the observation from all the panelist members, right? When we talk about IoT, we think primarily about technology. But for you to really succeed with IoT, it looks like probably the other factors that are surrounding it, like your team, the trust of the investors, the ecosystem support, partnerships, you know, all of those are equally critical or sometimes even more critical. And when people are thinking really about IoT ideas and succeeding as an IoT startup, I think, you know, it's very critical to really think about these other factors which can make or break your brilliant idea. So really thank you to all of you. Wonderful thoughts. Thank you to the audience, and thank you to NASSCOM for organizing things. Thanks.